Hello, and welcome to The Comic Cave. I'm Ramsey, a.k.a. Captain Away, and today I'm looking at the 2008 to 2009 series Spider-Man Noir. In 2009, Marvel decided they were going to do an entire line of comics about their characters set in an alternate timeline, with the look and feel of pulp fiction and noir films from the 30s and 40s. This started with David Hine, who wrote and created the character of the noir Spider-Man, but would go on to feature several other characters like X-Men, Daredevil, Luke Cage, and Punisher. Those last two especially, I feel, really strike me as appropriate characters for a noir-style story. Now let me start by saying that I'm actually a huge film noir fan, and if I ever did a YouTube channel about movies, it would basically be this channel, but about film noir. So yes, I am judging this comic on how much it actually feels like a noir film, and I have to say my conclusion is, not all that much. Stylistically, it feels much more like the neo-noir of the 70s and 80s, which tended to be more violent and influenced by other old B-films, particularly horror films. That said, I do really appreciate that this series doesn't flat-out pander to expectations, like not going pure black and white like a Sin City comic. Instead, it is full color, but uses very muted tones to help emphasize the classic noir feel. It also sets the time period back to the 1930s, moving all the characters back to places and jobs that seem most appropriate to the time period. Sometimes that's actually the same job, like with J. Jonah Jameson still running the Daily Bugle, and sometimes it's really, really not. So come take a trip with me in the Wayback Machine, and let's take this away. The comic opens on a city of darkness and shadows, built on secrets and lies. A city that turns bad men into monsters and makes good men into criminals. Ahem! The story starts at the offices of the Daily Bugle, with these police officers rushing in to respond to a call, supposedly from J. Jonah Jameson himself, saying he's been shot. They burst into the office to catch their suspect red-handed, one trench coat-clad Spider-Man. Except, like, I doubt Spider-Man would have shot Jameson, then let him call the police, and then sat around and waited just long enough for the police to show up. Sounds more like this is a frame job to me. To understand just how we got to this point, let's take a noir flashback to 3 weeks earlier. The year is 1993, the country's still in the grip of the Great Depression. A shantytown, or Hooverville, is growing along the bank of the Hudson. As the hard-boiled, world-weary, jaded narration tells us, Jameson sent our hard-boiled, world-weary, jaded narrator, reporter Ben Urich, to go get some pictures of the people living in the park. Because misery means business, and business is booming. While there, Urich runs into a mob gathered to listen to May Parker, a no-good, dirty commie preaching out the benefits of socialism. She's actually primarily running a homeless outreach center and just rebel-rousing on the side. I love that this comic, despite being an alternate Spider-Man origin story, didn't take May back to her fragile old woman character from early Spider-Man days, but instead seems to be drawing from the reinterpretation we saw in the Brand New Day arc, which itself had only started 1 year earlier. But there are some people who don't appreciate Aunt May like I do, and they want her to shut her lip before they're forced to shut it for her. These men, the noir versions of the Enforcers, an old group of Spidey villains consisting of martial artist Fancy Dan, appropriately named Hulking Behemoth Ox, and whip-wielding Montana, work for the Goblin. The Goblin is some sort of kingpin of crime, but not the actual kingpin, as he's more of a Daredevil villain, so Marvel was probably saving him for Daredevil Noir. Any longtime Spidey fan would probably guess that the Goblin would be the Green Goblin, otherwise known as Norman Osborn, and yeah, you'd be right. The whole city knows it, but nobody seems to care, something young Peter Parker just can't seem to get his mind around. The Goblin and his men killed Pete's Uncle Ben in this universe, apparently setting loose a pack of wild dogs on him, as the story goes, though there's no proof. But Pete was the one who discovered the body, so he saw it before the cover-up and knows from the rope burns that Ben was tied up, which also means that, rather gruesomely, he was alive when he was eaten. Yikes. Between this and the Depression, Pete has been left an angry, bitter teen. He strikes at the Enforcers when they try to stop his Aunt May from socializing all the homeless. He's saved only by the intervention of Ben Urich, who gets a picture of the men picking on the family and threatens to print it if they don't leave peacefully. They're stopped from breaking his face and his camera by a reminder from Fancy Dan that Urich is off limits for some reason. Though he knows better than to interfere, Urich is taken with Peter and decides to bring the young man in under his wing. First, he tries to disillusion Pete by taking him to a speakeasy run by Felicia Hardy.
I like how Felicia asks him if he's old enough to drink, and he replies that he'll show her his birth certificate if she shows him her liquor license. It's a good line, and a good bit of history. In 1933, prohibition was still in effect, and driver's license, at least as means of identification, weren't really a thing yet. Ben points out that the speakeasy has gathered together wealthy industrialists and important politicians rubbing elbows with brothel owners and crime bosses, like the Goblin. He's trying to show Peter that all levels of the system have formed into a circle of corruption, so that there's no way to fight any of it because there's no one left who will persecute any of these people for their blatant crimes. Peter's unwilling to accept these terms, though, so in order to both keep him alive and help him fight the system, Yurik brings Peter to Jameson to get him a job at the Bugle. So Peter begins working under Yurik, following him from one crisis to the next, continuing that money from human misery plan. This includes a tenement fire, and Yurik explains to Peter how the tenement owners will set these themselves in order to cash in on the insurance, to make up for the loss of money from their tenants that are unable to meet rent. Peter realizes that they got a shot of Fancy Dan in the crowd, and that the man probably set the fire. Yurik tries to discourage Peter from doing anything with the photo, and rushes him out of the dark room, telling him to get the pics they took to the Bugle. Peter runs out, griping about everyone needing their daily dose of misery, leaving Yurik to stare long and hard at the photo of Fancy Dan, thinking to himself, everyone takes their cut. I love this shot. It's so noir, and in a wonderful way with that little narration box that you can only get from comics. It tells us so much about the plot and Ben's character, but it's so simple and subtle, with just this one little shot at the end of a page before we move on, that it's pretty easy to not pay much attention to it. We immediately cut to Peter, coming back to celebrate their work, gracing the front page. But Yurik is checked out right now, as he's been revealed by this point to be a coke addict. Or a heroin addict? I don't know drug things. So Peter takes a call meant for the Spider, an alias Yurik has been using, about some deal of the Goblins going down. So Peter shows up instead, but instead of finding any illicit drug deal or anything, it's apparently just a shipment of stolen art for the Goblins' personal collection. It's some spider-themed voodoo stuff, and when the Goblins' goons drop one of the pieces, it cracks open and outspill hundreds of spiders. They devour Fancy Dan, and one separates from the group and bites Peter. He then has a magical realism dream of a giant spider cursing him with power, and he wakes up to find himself hanging upside down in a spider web. He freaks out and falls, but his new spider sense and reflexes kick in, giving Peter a new sense of what he can do. He takes very quickly to his new powers, and the next day he's crashing through the Goblin's window in a prototype outfit to tell him his criminal days are through. But Peter is distracted by a familiar photo on the table, and he turns to see Yurik leaving the room. That's when he puts it all together, and he confronts Yurik outside to yell at him for being a sellout. It's enough to push Yurik out of his safe zone, and he decides he's going to take all the info he had been using to blackmail the Goblin and publish it to expose his dirty ways. But when Jameson shows up at his place to collect it, instead of helping Yurik, he shoots him dead. The narration then immediately switches to Peter's, which is a nice touch. We see him gear up in a new costume created from items in his Uncle Ben's World War I trunk, including his service revolver, and we kick off the second half of this series with an image of the Spider being dead and the Spider-Man being born. The second half of the story focuses on Spidey doing whatever a spider can to shut down the Goblin's operations, while the Goblin wrestles to maintain his control over the town and find out who the Spider-Man is. He quickly realizes the hero knows too much about his operations, meaning he had to get his information from Yurik's missing files that Jameson was unable to find after showing up and killing Yurik. That's because Yurik didn't trust Jameson, and so he gave his files to Felicia as a precaution, and also tells her that Peter is Spider-Man. This means Felicia was in the next room when Jameson shot Yurik, so she gives Peter the files, warning him to not give the files to Jameson, but to otherwise do with them as he sees best, knowing he was likely to go the vigilante route. Felicia then does her own bit of vigilanteism, showing up to the Bugle and gunning down Jameson in his chair. But it seems that Noir Spider-Man inherited that Parker luck, and so unfortunately it's right after that he wanders into Jameson's office to ask him why he's been saying so many mean things about him in the papers. I love that little drawing of a Spider-Man. His little shoes on each foot, so great. This is when we finally get back to that in media res opening of the cops bursting in to find him hovering over Jameson's corpse. I feel like this is a bit of a cop-out, honestly. Like, they had the idea for this scene, but not really a clear thought on how they would get to it. We've been waiting the whole series to get to this point, and then it just kinda ends up being a throwaway aside, not really important to the story at all. honestly disappointing. At least we do learn from this that the man who shot Yurik wasn't Jameson, but actually an imposter. Spidey realizes from something the fake Jameson said just before dying that it was actually the Chameleon, the man with the putty face. This is something I really like about this story, the idea that the Goblin drew all of his crew from the circus. Fancy Dan, Ox, and Montana, we're told, were all carnies. Ox probably the circus strongman, the noir version of Kraven the Hunter was an animal trainer, and the Vulture was a geek. Not like a nerd, a carnival geek, which was someone who would bite the heads off small animals, just for show. The Vulture in particular has gone off the deep end from years spent doing this, and has come to resemble his namesake not just in appearance. And in fact, it wasn't wild dogs that ate Ben Parker alive, it was the Vulture. So when Peter next returns home to see the Vulture attacking his Aunt May, all he can see is the body of his uncle, torn apart by the very same attacker, and he fires Ben's service revolver, killing the man. Yeah, this Spider-Man is a killer. May is surprisingly not thankful. She's furious with Spider-Man for killing an unarmed man, even if it was moments away from killing her. She says she doesn't want to live in a world where people kill each other like animals. She also does make a good point about how he could have used his webs. It's what other Spider-Men would have done. She demands he give her the gun so that he can't kill again. But Peter knows the Goblin is still out there, and last time they met, the Goblin said the only way to stop him was to kill him. So Pete runs off, taking the gun with him. He confronts the Goblin, who has the real Jameson locked up with a tiger, and Felicia held hostage. Spidey bursts in and fights the remaining enforcers and Kraven. Kraven tries to shoot him, but Pete manages to maneuver his way around, so instead Kraven shoots Ox. Then he kicks a defeated Kraven into a giant glass container filled with the spiders that came out of that statue earlier. Because they somehow collected all those spiders and for some reason kept them? The Goblin runs for it, but Peter catches up to him and they have a showdown where they both unmask the other. It's a bit of a reversal reveal of the original Green Goblin, where he was wearing the Goblin mask and Peter pulled it away to reveal Norman Osborn. Here, the human is the mask, somehow, and apparently he was also one of the members of the freak show with the other carnies. Norman says he can see it in Pete's eyes that he's finally ready to kill, which like, yeah, duh, he has already. Yet despite the fact that he has now killed, basically, Vulture, Ox, and Kraven, he suddenly changes his mind and says he won't kill the Goblin. But then Kraven shows up, covered in spiders, in a weirdly ridiculous moment, and drags Osborn to hell, or the sewers, or something. And Peter's, okay with it. The comic ends with a reveal that Yurik and Felicia had once been lovers, until she maybe left him to be with Osborn, which, gross. There's also the hope for a brighter tomorrow, with the Goblin and his men all dead or behind bars, and Prohibition coming to an end. But that doesn't mean there aren't other monsters on the horizon, like Hitler, and the man with the very German-sounding name of Otto Octavius. But for now, there's just a Spider-Man, so let's get to the breakdown. There are a lot of things I like about this story. The 1930s setting, the new take on old characters, the attempted noir style. The art is pretty good, especially the colors, which serve the noir feeling really well. But it also has an almost wavy, messy feel to it that doesn't seem like it'd be what you'd want. Noir is about contrast, and all those lines start blurring together on me the more I look at it. The writing isn't especially great either, and they certainly didn't dedicate to making it feel overly pulpy or Raymond Chandler-esque, and honestly, I'm unsure whether that's a good thing or a bad thing. It almost feels like their primary focus was on violence, which doesn't seem either necessary or appropriate to the style. It also feels pretty rushed, probably because it was only a 4-issue series, but the pacing feels very off to me. It takes the entire first half just to have Peter become Spider-Man, leaving everything to resolve pretty quickly in the remaining half. Especially the very sudden feeling decision of having this Spider-Man kill. And that especially when coupled with the even more sudden feeling decision to have him not kill the Goblin. I really feel like we needed more build-up to both those decisions, and might have had them if this comic had been slightly longer. So in the end, I'm giving this series a recommendation level of medium. I think if it had been 6 issues, it would have really had the chance to pace itself well and shine brightly, but instead, it gets a little lost in the murky dark. Thank you. Thanks everybody for watching. Despite being a little disappointed in this comic, it was a lot of fun to cover. I'm definitely going to have to cover the rest of the Noir series someday. For now, go see Spider-Man Far From Home in theaters over this hopefully long July 4th weekend, and then come back here next week as I make the final push to finish the Infinity series. I hope to see you then, right here in the Comic Cave.